whose secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Himself being the chief cornerstone, Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their doctrine, that we may be made a holy temple, acceptable unto thee, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
And when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu the son of Nimshi shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. So he departed thence and found Elisha the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him. And he with the 12th, and Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, Let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he said unto him, Go back again, for what have I done for thee? And he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen and slew them and boiled their flesh with the instruments of the oxen and gave unto the people, and they did eat. Then he arose and went after Elijah and ministered unto him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, of St. Paul to the Galatians. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with a yoke of bondage. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty, only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this: thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if ye buy to devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are in Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers before his face, and they went, and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And they did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. But when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, Wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? But he turned and rebuked them, and said, Ye know not what manner of spirit ye are of. For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village, and it came to pass that, as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And Jesus said unto him, Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And he said unto another, Follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. Jesus said unto him, Let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. And another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. And Jesus said unto him, No man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
It's so secret, they got a hatch with a name on it. So it's, you know it's secret then. And there were 1,100 tickets sold, and Mary, and I call Mary Company, sold out on all of their sandwiches. What was it, Bill? 100 and some odd sandwiches that they sold? So all of that money's going to go towards some of the garden stuff. Thank you for all that came out for that. It was a busy weekend at St. John's. It's also busy for Jesus, who was walking to Jerusalem. He's walking to Jerusalem. Scripture says that his face was set. It's kind of really descriptive, right? When I think of your face is set, I think of a Marine, right? Going to a location for a purpose, clearly defined, without distraction. And that's where Jesus is headed. Jesus is headed to Jerusalem. And what happens in Jerusalem? He gets crucified. He knows where he is going. He knows he's going to fulfill his purpose on earth to give his life so that we can all have life. And he is headed that direction. I know that feeling of being determined of where you want to go. And you do too. You know when you have to get somewhere and no one's going to get in your way. Jesus is headed there and he's looking for some followers. And three people show up. First person shows up and says, Jesus, to Jerusalem. Jesus tells him, you have no idea what you're getting into. Let me tell you, when you give your life to serving Jesus, you have no idea what you're getting into. It is not what you expect. It is filled with turns and curves and hills and ups and downs. You never know. Jesus, as a matter of fact, it is so unstable, you're not even going to know where you're going to sleep. Birds have a nest. The foxes can dig a hole. I have nowhere to sleep. Let me remind you, we are talking about God. Jesus is saying, I have nowhere to sleep. Do you really, really want to follow me? Do you really want to be a disciple? Do you really want to go on this journey with me to Jerusalem? And then he walks a little longer, and then the second person shows up. Jesus says to him, a phrase that he's used before when he's called other disciples, follow me. You know what, Jesus? I will follow you, but I have to go and bury my father. We would all sit here and say, that sounds pretty reasonable. In fact, it's part of our culture that comes down from Judaism that is a moral obligation to take care of the dead. Right? And here's this guy who says, Jesus, I want to follow you. I got to bury my father first. We don't even know if his father's died. But he's telling Jesus he has to bury him. And Jesus says, let the dead bury the dead. Now, can I just tell you that? These are one of those moments where the scripture comes up and you're like, I got nothing. Because it doesn't make sense. But here's what came to me this morning, early in the morning. I wonder, now this is one of those I wonder what if things, okay? This is why you have a page in your bulletin that says sermon notes. And I need to have an extra page so I can bulletin even. But I wonder if the reason Jesus said the dead can bury their dead is because remember what the earlier scripture is, his face is set for Jerusalem. He's going to his crucifixion. What happens at his crucifixion? He conquers death. He conquers the power of death. And his resurrection gives us life. So really what he's saying to that person is, let the dead bury their dead, because I'm headed to a place where death has no power. Ooh, how about that? Sometimes I get good things early in the morning. And then the third one. I want to follow you, Jesus, but I got to go home. I got things I got to do. I got baseball. Kids got soccer. Oh, this is going to get touching. I got things I got to do on Sunday. I can't help you. I don't want to. But as soon as I get all these other things done, then I'll follow you. And I'll be on the way. So you go ahead and you start for Jerusalem. I'll get my stuff done and then I'll catch up. This line from Jesus is actually, I think, more direct than let the dead bury the dead. He says, if you have put your hand in the plow and you've looked back, you're better off not even starting. That's heavy. You know what that makes me feel like? I'm better off not starting. Right? Like, why do this at all? Y'all can have it. Thanks for all you do. I'm going to sit back and not even get involved. But here's the thing. There's this word called grace, and there's this thing called second chances, and third chances, and fourth, and fifth, and sixth, and seventh chances, where God has given us enough grace that we try and we try again. We grab the plow and we go forward, and then when we fall down, Jesus says, get up, I still got you. And we keep pushing that plow to do the work that God has given us to do as disciples. Being a disciple means that we give all of ourselves to him. That's what Jesus is saying in the gospel, is you have to give me all of you because I am giving you all of me. That is what it means to follow Jesus, that he is a God who believes in second chances. He believes in resurrection. There is death, but there is always hope for resurrection. When you mess up in your life, all the things that Paul really enjoyed listing in the epistle this morning, when all those things happen, God says, I still have you. Believe in me because my son set his face on Jerusalem. You have hope for tomorrow. So get back up and grab that pile and keep pushing forward. I am preaching to myself today as much as I'm preaching to you. Grace is always greater than law. I'm going to finish with a little story and then we'll leave. I mean, I'm not going to leave. Remember I told you I was up early? I'm tired. When you need a story, then I'm headed out. So in liturgical stuff, you know, we wear all these clothes. Does anybody know what this is? It's called a chasuble, right? Do you know what the word chasuble means? It actually means little tent. It's so that when you were traveling, you could travel and you would sleep in this, right? Protect you from the elements. Or if you were scared, you could kind of be like a turtle and just kind of hide in it. But it represents grace. We're clothed in grace. And then under the chasuble, by the way, just as an aside, whenever you watch shows and they have priests in it, and the stole is always on the outside of the chasuble, I always want to write them a letter, and here's why. So what does the stole represent? A couple things. One, it represents Jesus at the Last Supper, when he was serving as like a towel, but it also represents the authority of the office of the priesthood. What is greater? The authority or the grace? Yeah. The law still exists. The authority is still there. The sin is still there. But because of what Jesus did going to Jerusalem, his grace covers up all of our stuff. And that gives us hope for tomorrow. That gives us hope to keep going. So when you see the chasuble, know that it's grace. But if the priests come out without the chasuble on and just the stole, somebody drove. So walk in love, walk in grace. Don't give up, grab the plow and keep going. Because God has a purpose for you, for me, and for this parish. It will be a year this week. It is hard to believe that my thinking on yesterday said we were packing our trucks from Columbus, Ohio, getting ready to come here. 3 weeks from today, we would have our stuff. I am grateful to each one of you. God has a plan for us, and we are going to follow it. And that gives us hope. Amen? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, in thanksgiving for the gift of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, and in thanksgiving for all the blessings of this life, including those for whom we offer our thanksgivings now, silently or aloud. The birthdays this week of Christopher, Finn, Kate, Deacon Buck, Patricia, Emily, Rachel, and Ainsley. For the wedding anniversaries of Bill and Pat, Michael and Crystal, and David and Phyllis. We remember those for whom our prayers have been asked, especially those on the parish prayer list. For all those affected by the coronavirus pandemic, and for all those for whom we pray now, silently or aloud. Among them, we remember Liz, Alex, Patrick, Richard, Murray, Joseph, Rita, Francis, and Camille. And we pray for the repose of the souls of the departed and for all those we remember now, silently or aloud. Especially remember Owen Brewer. And those whose year's mind falls this week, Louise and Rosalie, Louise Grice, Denise, Ralph, and Helen. For the departed members of the Guild of All Souls, for the departed sisters and associates of the Holy Nativity, for all those who have died in the war in Ukraine, and for those who have been victims of violence in their own country, may their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercies of God, rest in peace.
Father, we pray for the Holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve thee.
That thy name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of thy word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice.
Give us grace to do thy will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in thy sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let the light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise thee for thy saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of thy people. In the multitude of thy mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to thee for help. For thou art gracious, O lover of souls, and to thee we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God without wavering. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ,
maker of all things,
judge
mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries this week? If you have a birthday anniversary, meet me at the steps for a prayer and a blessing. You better pass the blessing. Yeah, you have a birthday. You guys have an anniversary. They've just been married. They're celebrating the 57th anniversary. And you're celebrating their 13th birthday. A new teenager. That's pretty good. Oh, and it's your birthday. Justin Deacon's birthday. He's 26. We stand before you this morning celebrating another year of life and another year of love together in wedded bliss. Send them your blessings. Be with them this year. Watch over, protect them. Give them the grace to do the work you have given them to do. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Happy anniversary.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
All right, peace everybody. Peace, choir.
Peace, Peter.
Welcome home. We'll be heading back. No, it's summer. All right. It's good to see everybody. Few announcements and we'll keep this going. So this week, Monday morning prayer at 8:30, evening prayer at 5:30, Tuesday Mass at 6 o'clock. Wednesday will be the Chosen at 6 also with dinner. We are coming up on, I think, 2 months at least of doing this. And we are getting to the point where people are really beginning to peel back some layers of their relationship with God and how they desire to follow Jesus. So if you're missing out, on a good show, a good conversation, and really good food. So you don't want to miss that. And then on Thursday, evening prayer at 5:30. And then Friday, the 1st of July, I'll be on vacation from the 1st until the 9th. So for those days, the rectory is in a different zip code. We're not going anywhere, but our son and his girlfriend are coming in from Columbus, and we'll see what that week brings. We're excited to have him here. So we will be in and out. Mother Stephanie will celebrate on Sunday for both the 8 and 10 o'clock Mass, and we're excited to have her with us. I think that's it. We talked about the Secret Garden, which was absolutely amazing. There's lots going on. There's lots of traffic and people seeing the church. And we are thrilled to have people visit us. But always remember, we are not a museum. We are a church for people to come who are broken to find a place of peace and hope. We welcome it. We have so much to offer. But there's so much more than what they just see. And that's in you. That's who you are. So thank you for being you. Amen? Okay. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Hear us, and let all my
beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ.